Hey, buddy, it's Matt Maher. And if I had the short list, if someone said to me, who are people that when you hear the phrase Christian music are the kind of people that, not based necessarily on their own merit or own actions, because they wouldn't want to be based on that, but just based on how God seems to shine through them in such a remarkable way, who are the people that you think of when you think of Christian music? I think definitely one of those people on a very short list for me has always been a person that I'm so excited to talk to today, and that is my good friend, Mr. Mike Weaver.
That was a nice thing to say, dude.
Dude, here's the thing. I met you, we were talking about this earlier, 22 years ago.
It's so, oh my gosh.
Long time ago in Phoenix, I was working at a church. You were a brand new artist.
Yeah.
Your first album hadn't even come out yet.
No, it was like a family bookstore, like manager's conference
yes,
or something.
Yeah, well,
like
it was, yes, it was. Yeah,
in, playing like showcases at that thing.
Yeah.
And we were geeked out because Third Day was there. Yeah. We were like huge Third Day fans.
100%.
Oh my gosh, does he really sound like that in person?
Yeah, does Mac Powell talk like Mac Powell all
the time? Oh, yeah. And he surely does.
He really, really
it's
does.
It's incredible. Yeah. It's even better in person. It's
like, you know, I think it was at that event, a friend of mine, my roommate at the time, had gotten a poster autographed, and he got it framed and gave it to me. So I used to give Mac a hard time because it was right when their album, I think it was called Come Together, came out.
Oh, yeah.
And they were all like sort of like feathered out, like just like,
yeah,
just late 70s,
I can see the cover,
like,
in my mind.
Man, okay, in all its glory. It was incredible. If I could do that to my hair, I would. Why not? Why wouldn't you do that?
I remember it, man. We got to comb together. Yeah. I was like, dude, I loved that.
It was amazing. Like, and anyways, he'd signed the poster, said, keep writing them songs, dude. So I did. I tried. But I remember we hung out, and I was just, and this is the thing about you that I love so much, is that you're an incredible musician.
Oh man, dude.
And I like incredible singer, like great guitar player, like
man,
really
dude.
Great chops,
so kind.
Great sense of time, great pocket. But the thing that you lead with isn't your ability or your prowess, but it's your steadfast belief that the greatest thing that you have to share with someone is your testimony of who Jesus is.
Dude, man, you made me cry before we even started good, dude. Dang, man. Because we respect you so much as a musician.
No.
You are like the musician, you know what I mean? And we love, that's what we've always been. I was trying to think, I got to go back for just a second there.
Yeah, yeah.
Because so let me like commandeer your show here.
Yeah,
or whatever.
You go right ahead.
But so at that point, because I think we met at like a, it was IHOP or some like Waffle House, some kind of thing. Like
it was an IHOP.
It was after the manager's conference
like
had finished for the night.
Yeah, 10 o'clock at night.
And so, but had Chris Tomlin recorded Your Grace Is Enough yet?
No.
Man, because I remember the day I heard that song, and I guess that was probably it then. That was that guy, you know what I mean? And like, you know? And it was so amazing. But I remember telling our label president at the time, we had a little bit label, telling Susan Riley that like, man, there's this guy, Chris Tomlin. You got to hear him. He's really got something going on.
That's
now all over the world, you know. And it's like, it's unbelievable.
You tried to get Chris Tomlin a record deal. That's
I was
incredible.
Just trying to do my best for, you know, and so it turns out he didn't need my help in any way.
So, okay, just to recap, like, tell us a little bit, tell me a bit about your story.
My story or Big Daddy Weave's story? The story of
both.
My brother Jay and I grew up on the Gulf Coast.
Yeah.
My dad was never a minister in the official, like, you know, that was his vocation.
Hmm.
But he ministered in this little Methodist church that we were at. He was in every lay position that you can have, non-paid position that you can have, and then finally graduated to custodian at the end of all of it. When he was tired of all the committees, when he was tired of all the other stuff.
That, wow.
And some of my favorite memories of him, never a professional singer, but him worshiping Jesus with a vacuum in the sanctuary of that little Methodist church. We grew up there. We didn't go to church to learn. We went to church to serve. That's what we learned. We learned from my dad. My dad would host a thing on Friday nights. They just called it share group. They didn't know what to call it. And he was just growing in a real life relationship with Jesus, you know? And we had VHS tapes of different guys that he was listening to. And, you know, my mom would cook something amazing. She would bake something amazing. My favorite memories are hearing my dad vacuuming our house, singing those worship songs with the like early, early, like, I don't know if it's like Hosanna Integrity or something. Kind of like worship music playing in the house. My mom baking something that smelled delicious. That's why we are called to this day Big Daddy Boom.
Your mom's cooking.
Yeah, it was. And so, but then people coming to just sit and just fellowship in the Lord and to grow in the Lord. And then to see God call those people into the mission field, to call people into different things in their life, man, because Jesus had changed their life on the living room floor you know, at the Weavers. And I love it, you know? And
wow.
So we got involved in music and I met the guys from Big Daddy Weave at the University of Mobile. I never wanted to go to college, but I had a pastor who was like, you know, if you're going to lead worship, then we want you to be a student and you need to be looking forward and all of these things. And so he kind of sent me to school about probably 90 minutes away from our little church, where our church was in Gulf Breeze, Florida, the greater Pensacola area, to Mobile, Alabama, which you don't know where that is unless you've been there, you know, and you don't know how to say it because everybody's like, where is Mobile?
Yeah.
You know, it's like, I don't know. It's a Mobile is in, you know, over in South Alabama. And I met the guys the first semester at University of Mobile. We were leading worship on campus and it's like, we never stopped. That was like 25 years ago, dude.
Wow.
So it's been amazing. It's been an amazing journey, man.
Man, you just said so much in that, just the fact, like, I mean, I'm sitting there thinking of like, oh, that's why it's just funny how so much of our stories come out in what we do in a way. Like the fact that I love the fact that you said my dad graduated to custodian because like just that alone to say that's like a kingdom perspective. To say that actually, well, the greatest thing that you could graduate to is being a servant. And just how you said we showed up to learn. We didn't show up to learn. We showed up to serve.
They showed us that, you know? They showed us that. Mom and dad both.
So was your dad like a singer? Was he a really good singer?
He just had a naturally good voice.
Yeah.
But he was... Like, he talked about being so afraid growing up being around people. And we have some of that, too, that in my life, I'm just terribly afraid to, like, in school, growing up in school, every single day, just being afraid of standing out or being afraid of being the focus in some way. And just, I mean, it was, just an absolute kind of terror to me. And I feel like I received that from him.
Yeah.
But in these moments when he would be called to share, he was just sharing naturally, like, out of his life. He could just do it. And man, it was always, I always saw the Lord use that, you know? Never on a stage really, but just with people though, you know?
Do you think in some ways too, it's like that thing of like, you have this gift and like what you said with that gift, the times that you use it best are when you're not even aware. Like it's not about you.
Man, that's right, yeah. Because the pressure's off, man, you know? I don't deal with the pressure.
You don't deal with pressure very well.
Oh, man, I try to run away from that, you know?
Right.
Yeah.
So then you go to college and you're leading with a worship band. And then in that, what's great about leading worship is that when you're really doing it...
You can disappear. That's exactly it. Because in my classes, man, I was so afraid. When they're coming down the aisle, you know, they're going to ask you the next question. About two people before it got to me, I would break my pencil lead conveniently, leave all my books in the classroom. And just leave.
And just walk out.
I would just leave. And I'd come back after the class was done because I literally, it felt like this, I got to get out of here. Like I got to escape. You know what I mean? And so, but then for some reason, when we get up and sing, we're like, man, close your eyes and, you know, let's focus on the Lord. That was a different thing, right? And, you know, because we're pointing him out. We're not pointing us out. And that was a different thing. So both things could kind of exist at the same time.
Yeah.
Which, you know, I feel like in some ways in that other area, I would kind of stiff arm the Lord, except for in this one place where it felt safe or whatever, you know.
And this is the interesting thing about being a musician when you talk to other people and they just assume because you're standing up on a platform or you're standing up in front of other people that you're just so well put together.
Mm-hmm.
And sometimes you're like, no, like I'm not, like this is actually a burden in a way because it's not naturally what I want to do. I mean, I don't know if naturally it's what anybody really wants to do.
No, right. There's this time, like, so we grew up in the little Methodist church, but my dad was having just these ongoing encounters with Jesus and the Holy Spirit. And he had carved this place out in his closet. And I remember looking for my dad at one point on a Saturday. He worked civil service all week long on old mainframe computers. Like one computer takes up an entire room, right?
Wow.
So for the government.
It's the original Geek Squad. Like the
totally,
like,
dude.
Wow.
And so, but I remember asking my mom, where is dad? And he literally is on his face for us, man, for hours, man. I'm telling you, in this closet that he had, you know? And anything that's ever happened good around or for Big Daddy, I'm telling you, we drink from wells that we did not dig. You know what I mean? Hmm. My dad prayed this stuff. But in his pursuit of the Lord, he had heard about this place in Destin, Florida that he went down to. And he took all of us there. Back in the day, there was no phone or a tablet or something to like occupy your mind with. We got dragged to some of these meetings and we just had to sit there and be in it, you know? There's the first time I ever saw drums in church, right?
Oh, wow.
So, dude, in our Methodist church, we don't have any drums. We don't have anything. We got a piano. We got an organ. That's like it. And so I'm like, whoa, drums. So I'm like, things are looking up already for whatever this service is going to be just because I want to see who's going to play that. You know what I mean? And so I'm 11 years old, man. And then this guy gets up and he ministers. And at the end of the service, he goes, everyone who feels a strong call into like the mission field. And then he points at me. And he goes, and you. And I just about passed out, dude. Because we had cable, but we didn't have like HBO. And I thought that this guy who was calling me down front was going to tell my mom and dad that I've been trying to watch HBO through the scrambles on the TV, dude. I was like, I am sore afraid. You know what I'm saying?
He read my soul.
I'm a dead man, dude. You know what I mean? When he tells my mom this,
oh,
I'm never going to recover. You know what I mean? So I go down there with much fear and trepidation. I'm bargaining with God. I'm making promises of going to like places around the world that are in desperate need.
Oh my goodness.
You know what I mean? And the guy gets to me and he goes, when we were worshiping the Lord, he goes, I saw music notes written on your face.
Wow.
And I was like, honestly, I was like, oh, thank God. I don't know what you're talking about, but thank the Lord he's not about to get me in trouble somehow. And he just said, one day you're going to write songs. And he said, the songs are going to take you far away from your home, even to a foreign land. And then he said this, I sure wish I had listened to this.
Wow.
He goes, not everybody's going to like the songs, is what he said. He said, but don't even give it a second thought. He said, it's the Lord who's wanting you to do this. And he said, you just need to feel good about that, right? I wish I had like let that sink in, because it would have saved all kinds of times of feeling lesser than by comparing myself to somebody else or whatever thing. And then I could have walked at rest in the call of God somehow, you know. But I didn't really think about it too much. I was glad that he didn't get me in trouble with my parents, you know what I mean? But then a couple years later, these little things start showing up, you know what I mean? And then you figure it out. You know how you do it first or whatever, you know? And that was the beginning of something, you know?
Wow. And so for you, songwriting was just always a natural extension of just being a worship leader.
Yeah, you know,
in some ways.
Yes, for me. And it was like something that almost, like I couldn't help in some ways. That's why I feel like, man, I look up to guys like you, because when we get in the writer room, like you have so many amazing ideas and you are so practiced at writing songs that you'll come up with a great song like right now. I feel like sometimes I'm like waiting for a good song. You know what I mean? And it sort of happens. This sort of inspiration happens. And then if I get too impatient to let it finish, then I come find, you know, the big guns or whatever.
Man, I mean, I don't know. I mean, that I don't want to dishonor your perception. But I think it's funny because I would look at you and I would say, well, what I've sowed in theory and in music and in harmony. And it was, and I was involved in ministry. It just feels like you've sowed in the mission field.
Mm.
Oh, like, man. And I can stand in that and be honest about it because of the fact that I believe wherever I am and whatever I'm doing is where God wants me.
Hmm.
Like, as long as I'm in right relationship with Him.
Amen. Right. Right.
And so it's, you know, one body, different parts. But I think that's the thing why, like, I look up, you know, you look up to me for one set of gifts and I look up to you for a different set.
That's a beautiful way to have a friendship and to have a relationship, isn't it? Well, it's the family of God, you know? Because yeah. I feel like growing up, to me, the family of God almost seemed like this token thing.
Yeah.
But it really is not, man. In a different season in my life, when I walk through some different things,
yeah,
then it, man, I value the friendships and the sense of family that is in the body of Jesus.
You know? For sure. And I think a lot of it, too, is because we can inherit family structures that aren't perfect.
Hmm.
And with it can come younger siblings and older siblings. I mean, sometimes I wonder, is that why the story of the prodigal son is the way it is, that an older brother who does everything right and a younger brother who's a total mess? And the older brother's like, man, what gives? I've been here faithful my whole life. I've been showing up every week doing all the things. And this guy literally, I mean, I heard it explained to me that the narrative of the prodigal son was actually a common parable that Jesus modified.
Is that right, dude?
Yeah. So in the traditional parable of the prodigal son, the older son squanders his inheritance. But in order to get your inheritance, your father has to die. So basically the younger son says to his dad,
oh my word,
I need it to be as if you're dead so I can go ahead and have my inheritance. And then I'm going to go waste it. And then that traditionally in the parable would happen. Rabbis taught this parable. And then it's the younger son comes back and he repents. And the father says, I don't forgive you. And that's the parable.
The parable is, dude.
You reap what you sow.
Wow.
That's it. And Jesus says, and as the father saw the younger son from afar, he ran out to meet him. It would have caused audible gasps. Because in Hebrew culture, in order to run, you had to pick up your tunic. And to pick up your tunic was seen as like a dishonoring thing for a man to do, to run.
Oh my
word. It's the father would have publicly shamed himself and brought judgment onto him for his actions to love his son. And I do think sometimes, like in the relationship of the body of the Christ in a church, I think especially in today's world that we live in, there is so much struggle with comparison. And that's, it's like there's a maturity about you that I've always loved that it's like, man, look, I know you're not perfect. None of us are.
Wait, man, gosh.
But I've just never sensed from you, like the thing I'm sure that in your struggles with comparing, it's like, why did this person get all this talent in this area or all of this? And like, why, or how is their path this way and mine is this way? Mm-hmm. But it seems like you know who you're supposed to work it out with.
Mm-hmm. It's it. Amen. Well, you know, comparison really is kind of the death of a thing, isn't it?
Mm.
You know, and you just live in this constant place of turmoil and never can just rest, you know, and man, when you realize that Jesus is enough, then, man, that's a wonderful place to walk into. I wish I could stay there. You know what I mean? Yeah. I feel like I have these moments there, and then I run out of the room and start all over again, you know?
Yeah.
It's like, but I want to live there, you know?
Man, it's making me feel like it's like you get this identity, you're given this identity in Christ. And that is your inheritance.
Mm. Mm-hmm.
And to compare yourself is to squander that identity.
Oh my gosh, dude. Yeah. Yep. That's right.
And because you just end up cashing it in for a counterfeit identity.
Mm-hmm.
That isn't even as valuable.
Yeah.
Like, you'll run through it real quick, no matter what it is. If it's your talent or your looks or your status or the amount of influence you have or whatever, like that, all of that stuff is going to fall apart.
Yeah, that's right.
But this inheritance that we have in Jesus that is everlasting.
Mm-hmm.
Wow.
I'm so grateful wow. for that, man. But I'm so grateful that he puts up with me while I learn how to really walk in that, man, you know? Because that's been it. I think for me, like even the name, the silly name of Big Daddy Weave,
right.
which the first time we ever got together was when we were just kidding, you know? But it was rooted in these things that were like kind of this humorous, you know, take on, you know, some of my insecurities, man, being a big guy. But there's a guy in the South, you know, at our church every Sunday, hey, Big Daddy, you know, it's like, you're my size, you are a Big Daddy. You're like, oh my God, I was like, you know, but it's like, and so the whole thing became this sort of persona,
right?
That I would use humor to like kind of deflect attention from these things that I really hated about myself.
Wow.
You know, to the point that I didn't even know how to come to grips with just telling God that I kind of hate me, you know, because I had been so into comparing and always finding somebody else better, you know? And I found that I would like wish that I would be them, you know what I mean? In a way. And there's this day though when the Lord just did a work in my life, or began a work in my life rather, you know?
Yeah.
When I had this huge list of things that I hated about me that I was literally bringing in front of the Lord and just saying like, God, I hate this. And he just literally was like, I don't agree with you. I made you. You know, I remember one time I was really upset looking in the mirror, which is not a dude thing. I don't know, but I really was. You know, it seems like more of like a girl thing maybe, or I don't know.
Maybe traditionally, but more and more men now are actually struggling with self-image.
I remember looking in the mirror. This is even after the Lord had this encounter me and really just said, I don't look at you the way that you look at you. I look at you through Jesus, right? That's who you are to me. You're my son because of Jesus, not because of you. You know, all the things that you hate or whatever you bring, like, look, I took care of all of that already, you know? And so, but I'm looking in the mirror and I'm like, I'm just completely frustrated, you know? And he goes, do you know what that is? And I'm like, what? And he just goes, mine. You're mine, right? And I just, yeah. I'm so grateful that that's who he is. He's always so kind. He's always been so gentle with me. It's not that you don't get the rebuke, but even when you get the rebuke from him, it's the most life-giving thing that's ever happened to you, you know? And I love that that's who he is. He could be so many other, you know, nobody bosses him around or tells him who to be.
Right.
But this is who he is to us, is kind and gentle and loving and, you know, almighty, absolutely. But so wonderful.
So one of the things that I've always known about you guys and your tribe is that you've always built what you do around your first calling, which is family, which has always been very inspiring.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, you're kind of in this season where even after you're sharing earlier, like even after, you know, grieving the loss of Jay.
Oh man. Yeah.
And working through that, your kids have now reached an age where they've been homeschooled and they've been on the road, and now they're starting to play music with you.
Mm-hmm.
You were just sharing about an experience.
Oh man, incredible, man. Well, you know, to back up for just a second, to get there. So my little brother Jay was a bass player in Big Daddy Weave. We did everything together. Man, God just really began to move in a different way in his life. He was the most fun, the most loving, the most, it was so many jokes, all that kind of stuff. But there's a moment when the Lord began to wake him up early in the morning.
Really?
And he just said that he would sit with the Lord at about 3 o'clock in the morning. And then he began to share things. And I was like, Jay, that has to be Jesus because you can't come up with this, you know? And then it took a turn in our shows too, where we just began to stop everything and just shut it down and just pray for people at the end of every one. In fact, I would find myself for a while, we saw God move in such a wonderful way. I would find myself rushing through the music part.
Just to get to the prayer part.
I wanted to see where we get to pray for people and see what Jesus is going to do tonight. And we literally just saw miracle after miracle after miracle for about 7 years. Jay was leading the charge in that.
That was all him.
It was, he just had a passion for it even more than all the rest of us.
Dude, I remember, it's so funny you say this because there are these touch, and that's, I think the thing I that's what I said, like you're a touch point for me because earlier on, before ever being in any of this and even writing any songs, it's like I meet this guy who's an incredible minister and worship leader. And then I remember talking to you and I remember hearing about this. I remember someone was telling me like, yeah, Big Daddy Weave's been, their concerts are turning into just basically prayer meetings.
Yeah, it was unbelievable. I mean, and we had a road manager out with us who some of the crew here today, we've been sharing about our friend Brad Fogarty, and he was our road manager. We were on the road together. He's helping lead the charge in that. He would bring students from his ministry school, like a discipleship school out. Man, they would be praying for you. Before long, it was like, it was incredible what the Lord was doing every night, man.
Wow.
And I told Brad before, I was like, man, sometimes I feel like, it was before The Chosen, but it was like, I feel like we're out with Jesus right now. And it's like, you know, that we're just one of the disciples or whatever learning every night, you know. But Jay, you know, it's like we saw the reality of the war that we're in too. Mm-hmm. And the enemy will get in any way he can. And so he used my brother's health. And man, to make a long story short, it was because of like a complication with diabetes and all that stuff. He had to have both of his feet amputated. It was a strong like backlash, you know. And we wondered if he could come back from it. He did. He was praying for people. He prayed over every seat in the place before anybody would ever get there. We just saw God continue to move in the miraculous. Even like we saw, man, people who were complete strangers to us receive miracles that Jay needed in his own body as his health continued to decline. And the beginning of 2022, because of his compromised health, he'd had to leave the road and he got COVID, and it was an awful thing. And it was such a surprise to us because he'd been through so much, but he went to be with the Lord on the 2nd of January, 2022. You know, it was like 2-2-2-2-2. Everything was on this day, right?
Wow.
It rocked us. It hurt us so badly. These last couple of years without him has just been this, man, this difficult walk through grief, but where we're still encountering Jesus, he's finding us in our grief. He's being with us in our grief. In the midst of this, going to work every day in Big Daddy Weave, him not being there, it just hurts, you know? It's like everything reminds me
of him.
Of him and him not being there because we were so close and we worked together. We did life together, every kind of thing. But the Lord is so awesome. Because our kids who have been growing up around all this time, have taken an interest in music, and at our house, in our garage, it does not look good. We closed it in, but it's like, it's the most redneckery I've ever seen of a thing.
Redneckery.
It's this space, man, that some friends of ours helped to close in, and we practice music down there together. And hearing them sing and hearing them play and seeing them worship the Lord it heals something in me. Recently, I was invited to go and play at a place that's so special to Billy Graham and his family called The Cove. It's a ministry center. It's like a retreat center. It's a place where people go and you can clear your mind and be in the mountains and see all the beauty and all this stuff. And I played there for, I guess this is probably the third time. This time I got to bring my kids and they played with me. And seeing them worship, it's about 2 hours away from a church called The Refuge in Concord, North Carolina, where Jay's oldest daughter, Mackenzie, 18 years old, is going to discipleship school. She feels a strong call to ministry. She's been shy her whole life I mean, when we have conversations, it's usually like I ask her a question, I get a one-word answer, right? But she feels called in the ministry. So this last year, she's been just kind of immersing herself and spending time with Jesus, being in this process. She came out to the Cove because it's only a couple hours away too. And we got to minister together. We played together. And then I asked Mackenzie, shy Mackenzie, Mackenzie, would you want to share something when we get there? And she was instantly like, yes. And I'm like, whoa, that's not the normal response.
Wow.
So we got to play. We played, and it comes to the time of the night where I told Mackenzie, you know, do you want to share? And I introduced her. I had shared about Jay, and I'd shared about him going to heaven and all these things and about walking through grief. The people didn't know she was going to be there. So there was a gasp there in the room when they heard that this is her. And she steps up. And the peace of God is just like on her. I've worried for her like so much. I can almost hear Jay say, the Father's a better father than I could ever be. And when she stepped up, she just said this. She said, it's good to be here tonight, isn't it? I remember moments in the last couple years where I didn't think it was going to be good to be anywhere ever again, you know?
Yeah.
And then she just said this. She said, the healer is in the room right now. And I'm a wreck, you know.
Yeah.
Still, you know.
Yeah.
And, man, so my kids, my oldest, Eli, 16, and my youngest, Naomi, came. And we just, with guitars, just began to sing. And we just moved into this time, just like we've done at Big Daddy Weave shows. Right. And with Jay, a gazillion times, you know. And the Lord's presence was so there. Matt, man, in those moments, I'm telling you, I'm not trying to come off as hyper spiritual.
Right, right.
But when his presence is so real, you know, he's never not there. But when you know beyond the shadow of a doubt, you get why David writes things like, I'm just asking you for one thing. Mm-hmm. I just want to live in your house. Let me live in your house, you know? And, as they began to pray, there's a man in the front row who was the first one to move forward, to come down for prayer. Mackenzie and some of her friends from the discipleship school were there. These young ladies all spread out across the front, just with hearts full of Jesus, you know? And the man with Parkinson's began to come down, and he'd been walking with a cane, and he left his cane and he tripped and he fell. And he went down, and the entire room was aware of it. Because the little room at the Cove, it's like everybody feels very close.
Yeah.
And man, something happened when he fell. Mm. And people just started coming. The girls are praying over him. They're praying over the people who are coming. Man, the presence of the Lord was so wonderful. We're just singing songs about his goodness, you know. And then I watched that guy get up. When he stood up, he stood without his cane. And he walked out of there without his cane. I wish he would go to the doctor and Jesus would say, like, Parkinson's is gone.
Right.
I don't see that every time.
Yeah.
You know, I've seen it happen before, though. Mm. You know? I love it when he does that, man. Mm. I know this, though, after what I've been through, if he doesn't do that, he's going to show up in some other way.
Yeah.
And he's going to use it. He's a redeemer.
Yeah.
He doesn't waste anything.
Yeah.
I love that about him. But that night, man, I'm telling you, when I went to sleep, I told my wife, Candace, I was just like, man, the Lord is so good, you know? We wouldn't want to miss this. Mm. You know, he takes even the bad stuff, man, and he turns it around. It doesn't make the bad stuff not hurt when you're going through it.
Yeah.
But you can't discount his goodness, you know? The bad stuff can't undo all of the good that I've seen, you know? And, I'm not so worried about Mackenzie anymore. I think she's going to do just fine.
She's going to be just fine.
You know, and because, man, she gets it, you know. And because she gets it, I feel like I get it a little more than I did before when I went in there, you know. It was beautiful, man. It was beautiful.
Wow.
Yeah.
So, kind of in this next season, you guys have new music coming out.
Oh, yes, we do. And in fact, the very next music that we have coming out was from a very wise and beautiful young man who...
Thanks for saying young.
Who wrote a song probably in this room. In fact, that was a question for me because I love being able to brag on songs that I didn't really get to be a part of writing. You know, it was in... So, in this time of grieving and everything else, you know, we've been writing our way through the grief. And I went to see Matthew West, who is the other Matthew in town or whatever, right? And when I sat with him and they just let me talk and let me grieve, it was really close to when Jay had passed. And you know, as I finished sharing, he had been kind of typing things on his cell phone as he looked me in the face. And he turns around and goes, Mike, this, what we're going to do today is not write a song. He goes, this is an entire record. He has like all these titles. And one of the things, one of the titles was Let Healing Begin.
Really?
Yeah. And so, and that was the thing. And so at some point,
I did not know this.
It's really amazing how it happened. And so I sat with a bunch of different songwriters and I said, we kind of planned out a thing. We're going to shoot for these kind of songs. And we even wrote from that place and tried to write these titles. Right. And then you call me kind of out of the blue at some point and you're like, man, we wrote this song. It was how long ago was the song? It was a couple years ago or something. Or
so that song was written in 2020, and it just sat around. And for like, it's just so gosh, God. I mean, I'm sitting here like floored. I'm just like hearing this for the first time and going, man, like. There is no better architect in the world of divine providence than God. Mm-hmm. You can't build, you can't write a better story than the one he's authoring.
Amen. That's right.
But you can be part of it.
That's man, isn't that awesome?
Yeah, it's incredible. So I did. I was in this room and I wrote it over Zoom with Emily Weispand, who's another writer in town.
That right, dude. That's amazing.
We had gotten together, and honestly, it was, you know, I've had chronic illness my whole life. I had hepatitis C from a blood transfusion. I've had chronic back pain in on and off. Praise the Lord, I haven't had it in a long time. But, so I've always understood, it's like what you said earlier, and that was kind of like why I wanted you to share that story. About your niece, mm-hmm. Mackenzie, and mm-hmm. when she said the healer is in the room. Mm. Because for me, 22 years ago, I was in a total fog. There's still kind of chunks of like a 2.5 year period that I don't have the best memory of. Mm-hmm. I was on a type of chemotherapy. Mm. I was... Like, I wrote Your Grace Is Enough during that time.
I didn't know that part.
Yeah, I had Hep C. And so, you know, and there's this whole thing in the Catholic Church. There's a rite, an anointing of the sick. And it quotes the letter, like the words that the priest says, they quotes James, you know, let anyone sick among you come forward.
Yep, lay hands on.
Yeah, and they anoint your hands with oil and everyone prays. And it's a powerful, visceral experience of the healing power of God. And yet you are still 100% in a posture of total surrender because you can't control the outcome. So... accepting the healing of God is first of all surrendering your concept of what healing is.
Yes. Oh man, that's such a good word, dude. Wow.
Because it's like, God, I want to be healed. And I love that in some ways, like Jesus says, what is it that you want? Culturally, when you're if you're a beggar in the time of Christ, it's actually almost in some ways an occupation. And so Jesus saying, it's like, what is it that you want when he's asking the man who wants to be cured of his blindness is that you're going to have to become a member, like you're going to have to move on from this season. If I heal you completely in this way, like your whole life is going to change. And so there's this aspect of us asking God for healing, but also surrendering and trusting that in the world of divine providence, he knows our greatest good. So it's like, well, I could have been healed of this physical illness, but that actually wasn't the healing in the moment that I needed. And it's a mystery, and it doesn't make the reality of illness any more real or any more difficult to walk through.
Right.
But in the architecture of the story of God, I know that all things shall be well, mm-hmm. and all things will be made well in the end.
Amen.
And so you got to play the long game.
Man, that's so right. That's so right.
With this. And you surrender and take what he gives you. So we wrote this. So I've always carried that experience with me of going like, I've been healed, I've been anointed, and I've received healing in my heart, healing in my mind and my thoughts. You know, for a lot of people right now, people are finding healing mm-hmm. in therapy. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? People struggling with depression, struggling mm-hmm. with anxiety.
It's
you know,
everywhere.
It's everywhere. And we discovered that, I thought I needed to be fixed from this, or I needed to be healed from this, but then it turned out I was actually, there was something else going on that was deeper. And so I think the experience of that came into writing this song in the middle of 2020. And for me at the time too, it was a lot of anxiety about the future. I was so yeah. worried. I was so stuck in a cycle of like comparing myself and mm-hmm. not feeling like I don't know what to do. I don't know mm-hmm. how to respond to this moment. So it's just that line of, you know, if my wounds could tell one story,
come on.
Let it be a testimony.
Yeah.
That you don't leave me where I've been.
If this is healing,
let it begin.
Let it begin. And you didn't even know that we had this like on our list, right?
No, I had no. So that I'm sitting here floored because okay, so that's the song title. And what happened was we did a Christmas concert in Phoenix in 2021.
Yeah. No,
2022.
It's 22, yeah.
So I didn't even know you were already sort of working on this and we sang I'll Be Home for Christmas.
Oh yeah.
Which we need to
We still gotta put that down.
We still gotta put that down.
Right after this, right
yeah.
after whatever.
Yeah. And so we got done and there was just something about I made my album stories to tell myself, but that song, I've always thought like, man, God has a plan for this song. Mm-hmm. And I don't, but it didn't get recorded.
The amazing thing to me about that, because there was something that happened that night. We were in Phoenix. We sang this song, but it was like, because we were on the phone before that and we're talking about what are we going to do? And you had a show. You had to kind of plan the entire show at some point or whatever. And it was like, there was a lot going on, a lot of moving parts. And it was kind of on your shoulders or whatever at one point.
Yeah, Crowder couldn't do it, the tour that we were on. So instead of finding one artist, I just had this harebrained idea of like, let's just get a bunch of people, you know? Like,
and it turned into a really beautiful thing.
It really was.
And so we had this idea of, you know, I'm like, what if we do I'll Be Home for Christmas from the perspective of like somebody who's just missing somebody this Christmas, you know? Mm-hmm. And then, man, it was like on the phone, you start singing this thing out and I'm like going, this is why you're Matt Maher. You know what I mean? It's like, dude, his grace is enough. I think this is like, good Lord, we just saw it happen like right now. And it was like, I'll be home. Oh, and it turned the whole thing and just focused it on Jesus. And it became this moment. And that night, it was a real moment. It was not put on. It was in front of a whole heap of people, but it was like there. I mean, it was not put on. And I just believe it's Jesus showing up to keep his word. He just says, blessed are those who mourn. Mm. And in the reason they're blessed is because they're going to get him.
Yeah.
And he showed up that night, you know, in the hurting, in the thing, you know. I just, man, it just makes me love him more, man. And so then this came out of that. When I heard the words, so let it begin, I mean, because it's beautifully written, which everybody can obviously tell was not me instantly, by the way. I just showed some friends because I was like, this is Matt Maher. You can tell, right? Because of the words. It's like he has a greater vocabulary than what I have, right? He did not come from South Alabama or whatever.
You know what I mean?
And dude, and it was, and it's like the sentiments of it, though. It's like he gave words to what is in my heart and where we are at in the journey, too, which is so important to me because it's real right now for us. I feel like we're walking into this song in a way, you know?
Yeah.
And it's really cool. But I love because the way it's written, it doesn't just have to be about somebody who is dealing with grieving the loss of a loved one.
No.
It's every kind of healing, you know, that is in the Lord, you know?
Yeah.
And I'm excited to sing it. So we've never sung it in front of anybody until a couple of days from now we're gonna sing it. So
really?
I'm having to learn the song for real now. Because you're in the studio and you're like tracking it.
Dude,
and that's one thing, you know.
But that's a whole thing that like it's like trying to explain to someone you write a song or you record a song, and then I tell people, okay, now I gotta go learn how to sing it. And they're like, what are you talking about? You sang it. I'm like, nah, it's not the same thing.
Yeah.
You have to kind of embody it in a way in your spirit and in your mind and in every facet. So you're not thinking about the physical act of singing and you're praying, you're spending more time listening to God while you're singing.
Yeah.
And being in the moment.
Yeah. And then now we get to learn how to use it every night.
Wow.
And so it's really cool, man. Thank you for that song, man. Thank you.
I mean, the first time I heard you sing it, it stopped me dead in my tracks because I think, and that's the thing, it's just that I know that you've had to walk through just a really, really hard season, you know? Mm-hmm. And it's funny, like even asking you questions, like I kind of dodged it a little bit because I was like, you're going to have to talk about this a lot over the next, you know, 6 months.
Yeah.
And I think there is an element of it, like with this project of what you were saying of like, it's the most interesting thing about grieving as a Christian is that grief is important.
Yes. Yes.
And it's like you said, blessed are they who mourn. Mm-hmm. So the blessing is in the willingness to be in the mourning.
Mm-hmm. Amen.
Like,
I really think we've done what that is.
Yeah.
Because that felt foreign to me, and it felt like, are you not in faith? Can't you rise up out of this and be like, you know? And I do have. It says we grieve, but not like those without hope, right? And I have that hope, but man, I miss my brother so bad. You know, and it was like, it was part of a greater story of loss because my mom and dad both went home in the last 5 years too. And it was like this entire little family that I was so blessed to have growing up is like, they're gone. And yes, I will see them one day, but it's not today. And today like really hurts.
Yeah.
And Jesus is so willing to visit today.
I feel like this is what, like in my faith tradition, this is why they call the Saturday between Good Friday and Easter Sunday, Holy Saturday. Because this is the moment. It's like if Good Friday is the inhale and Easter Sunday is the exhale, this Holy Saturday is the moment where the breath is just in your lungs. And you're holding
that's
it.
That's powerful, yeah.
But it is the willingness as believers to be in that place and don't rush it. Or like over sentimentalize the space in between Jesus suffering and dying and him rising from the grave. Mm-hmm. Like that day's there for a reason, you know? And I mean, I'm looking forward to this whole new project from you and just knowing because of this, knowing what you've walked through and how relatable you are as a person, I just know that God will honor your request to matter. But like I just know it. And you know, it's a weird thing to be going out on the road and sharing new music and also still grieving. It's like being a kid and it's cloudy outside, or it's sunny outside, but then it's raining at the same time.
Mm-hmm.
It's really confusing. Like you're like, these two things shouldn't be happening.
Make up your mind, right? It's like, yeah, I get that. Yeah, that's right.
But it kind of creates a more realistic depiction of faith in a way.
Yes, that's right. And I'm thankful for the kindness of the Lord. Because we saw the season of miracles first, and we saw his heart in that. Mm. You know what I mean?
And all those early years and traveling.
Just seeing him pour out. And then we also saw when that's not necessarily the answer right at this moment. And I don't have the answer to all of that. But I do know this. In the common thread is he is here. He's with us in the middle of it. In the days of power. In the days of, man, because when I saw Jay pray for people, and they received a miracle. Like, for instance, his kidneys were failing. He was doing dialysis on his tour bus. He prayed for people. I watched Jesus heal kidneys, get a call the next week. I'm coming home from the kidney doctor and have 100% working kidneys. Like, what? You know, to see Jay not get bitter when someone else got the miracle is a different kind of miracle. You know what I mean? That posture and that outlook and that all this, I mean, that was unbelievable. And it affects me to this day, you know?
That's the real stuff of Christianity. When you're praying for someone to experience something that you secretly are crying out that God would do in your life.
Yeah, yeah.
And it doesn't happen.
Yeah.
But you rejoice in the fact that you're seeing it happen in someone else's life. Man, that is the real stuff.
And seeing him walk in that way has left its mark on my life, you know, and even in my view of even walking through any kind of hardship, you know, and I thank the Lord because of the example that I saw in my little brother, who I kind of look up to, Rich. I don't know, it's not usually the way, but I saw that, and now it affects me to this day, knowing that, man, he walked like that. But man, I can grow in the Lord in that way too. I can follow Jesus in that way. And it's really just about where we put our eyes, you know?
Hmm.
Whether we put our eyes or whether it happened or not, I mean, we're always going to be in this turmoil, you know, one way or the other. But when we put our eyes on him, he's the constant, man. And he's the one who's walking us all the way home, you know?
Hmm. Bro, thank you so much.
Oh, man. I love coming to your house, dude.
I mean, we should do this without a bunch of cameras and people.
This is a magical room right here. Dude, there's no telling what all kinds of music has come out of this room, right?
Well, you and I definitely have an appointment for a couple more songs.
That's good.
To come out of here, so.
That's good.
Thanks for coming by.
No, it's an honor. Thanks for having me, man.